Bom dia, boa tarde e boa noite a todos. Sejam muito bem-vindos ao segundo e último dia da nossa conferência internacional. Hoje nós vamos explorar uma ampla variedade de tópicos, cada um oferecendo uma visão única sobre os desafios e oportunidades. Nós vamos discutir temas como educação, vigilância digital, migração climática, violência específica de gênero, justiça racial, violência baseada em gênero e muitos outros assuntos importantes. Nós somos imensamente gratos aos nossos estimados colaboradores da Escola Superior do Instituto dos Advogados Brasileiros, assim como agradecemos à Universidade Manipal e à Universidade Christ da Índia, à Universidade Tito Maiorescu da Romênia e à Universidade Nicolau Copérnico e à Universidade de Stettin da Polônia. A parceria e o apoio deles foram fundamentais para tornar esse encontro internacional uma realidade. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. Welcome to the second and final day of our international conference. Today, we will explore a wide range of international topics and important ones, each offering unique insights into global challenges and opportunities. We will discuss topics such as education, digital surveillance, climate migration, gender-specific violence, racial justice, gender-based violence, and many other important issues. We are also incredibly grateful to our esteemed collaborators from the Superior School of the International of the Institute of Brazilian Lawyers. We also thank the Manipal University and Christ University from India, Tito Maiorescu University from Romania, Nicolaus Copernicus and Szczecin University from Poland. Their partnership and support have been key to making this international meeting a reality. I'm now very honored to introduce Professor Osvaldo Lima, a professor at the Federal University of the State of Rio de Janeiro, and a respected academic with extensive experience in education and public policy. His work is dedicated to addressing contemporary challenges, particularly in the context of combating disinformation. We are honored to have him here with us today.
Thank you very much, Luisa. Good morning, all. It's a pleasure to me to be here again for our second day of meeting. Dear colleagues, today it's a very important day because I think that I will talk about one of the greatest challenges of our time. Disinformation and its impact on our society. The digital age, with its transformative potential, has brought us a new model of communication. However, alongside all this progress, it has also exposed a troubling vulnerability. The spread of fake news, which undermines the foundations of democracies and threatens social structure. Disinformation is not just about false content. It's a deliberate strategy to confuse, to manipulate, and to divide people. Fake news, with its veneer of credibility and calculated virality, influences elections, discredits institutions, spreads panics, and ultimately weakens the mutual trust that holds societies together. Its impact extends far beyond politics. Disinformation erodes fundamental rights, such as the right to information and the right to health. But if disinformation is a threat, education is its antidote. And here, more than ever, we need to robust public policies that place media literacy at the heart of citizenship education. Media literacy, it's so the key to equipping individuals with the skills needed to navigate the overwhelming flow of information that around us. In Brazil, the efforts of the Superior Electoral Court, or just TSE, in combating disinformation serve as a powerful example of how education can be mobilized to fight fake news. During recent election cycles, the court launched comprehensive campaigns aimed to educating the public about the dangers of disinformation and the importance of verifying information before sharing it. Through initiatives such as partnerships with social media platforms, public awareness campaigns, and the Eleições Sem Fake News, Elections Without Fake News program, the court worked to inform voters about the mechanisms used to spread false information and to empower citizens to identify and report fake news. These campaigns not only helped protect the integrity of electoral process, but also reinforced the importance of a critical and informed electorate. But media literacy alone is not enough. We need an education that goes beyond the technical analysis of information. We need to cultivate critical citizens who can question dominant narratives, evaluate evidence, and make informed decisions. Critical thinking is the cornerstone of any democratic society. It enables to resist sensationalism, to stand up to manipulation, and defend the truth in a world where falsehoods often appear more interesting. Achieving this requires thinking, teaching methods, promoting dialogue, empathy, and interdisciplinary approaches. So we can say that no educational transformation is possible without the support of public policies. Governments, civil society, and the private sector must work together to implement programs that encourage media literacy and promote ethical use of technology. In Brazil, local initiatives have shown that it's impossible to engage entire communities in fact-check workshops and in digital education campaigns. Scaling these efforts nationally through strong public policy is an urgent challenge we must embrace. Additionally, cross-sector partnerships can maximize resources and expand the reach of these initiatives. The private sector, particularly tech companies, has an important role to play in this field. Whether to funding or developing tools to combat disinformation. In conclusion, education and the educating process against disinformation is at its core educating for citizenship. It's a very important task of our time. It's about preparing individuals not only to recognize the truth, but also to defend this truth in an increasingly complex world. It's a commitment to democracy, to human rights, and the dignity of every person. So I invite each of you in your areas of work to join us in this effort. Let us build together a more informed, critical, and resilient society, one where truth prevails over deceit, and education becomes the foundation of a more just future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Osvaldo. I'm now very, very honored to introduce Marie Crabb, an Australian researcher whose work focuses on preventing the harms of pornography to young people. Her talks highlights the implications for implications for gender equality and youth well-being. Let's welcome her.
Thank you very much, Louisa. And I would like to share my screen. Is it possible to enable that?
Yes.
Hello, everyone.
Yeah, you can do it directly here at the sharing. Let me check. There is a sharing button at the end of the page. You can do it
it's
directly.
Telling me that it's disabled. Host disabled participant screen sharing. So
oh,
I just
okay.
Need to be made a co-host or something.
Oh, yeah, just a second. Victor, could you make her a co-host, please?
Thank you. Great. I'll share now. Okay. And thank you very much to the organisers for the invitation to present. I'm honoured to join you today, and thank you to the previous speaker. Can you see my screen okay? Yes?
Yes, we can.
Yes, you can. Great. Okay. I am going to talk about how pornography is impacting on children and young people, undermining their rights to be free from violence and sexual harm, and some of the public policy implications. There are five things that I think we need to understand about these issues. Pornography has become mainstream, the nature of contemporary pornography, its impacts on young people, how it's connected to gender-based violence, and we need to act to prevent pornography's harms. We've conducted interviews with young people, experts, and professionals from the international pornography industry, and I want to play you some very brief excerpts from some of these interviews to help tell this story. A content warning: my presentation includes confronting themes, explicit language, and some descriptions of violence. So, porn sites now account for 3 of the 15 most viewed websites in the world. It's huge. That puts it under Google and Facebook, but above many other very popular sites. With the click of a button, children or anyone can now access a vast array of free pornographic imagery online, and they are being exposed at high rates. A UK study found that 10% of children have seen pornography by the age of 9, over a quarter have seen it by the age of 11, and half have seen it by the age of 13. Young people might seek it out for a range of reasons, but they're also exposed at high rates unintentionally. For many children, it's actually more difficult to avoid pornography than to see it. Boys and young men are more likely than girls and young women to use it often, and to have positive views about pornography. This study from Australia that we released earlier this year found that over half of 15 to 20-year-old males use pornography at least weekly, and 1 in 6 reported daily or more frequent consumption. For young women, those figures were 14% reported weekly or more often, and only 1% reported daily consumption, so very gendered differences. So pornography has become mainstream. What is the big deal? To understand why that's an issue, we need to understand more about what they're seeing, the nature of contemporary mainstream pornography, which is the next key thing to understand. what pornography is like. Pornography is not new, and it's not new for young people to see pornography, but pornography is no longer the centerfold that it used to be 30 years ago. And when we think about pornography and its impact, it's important that we're not imagining this content. Since the advent of the internet, mainstream pornography has become not only more accessible, but also more aggressive. Here's performer Anthony Hardwood.
When I started, it was like very lovey-dovey sex. I can call this lovey-dovey sex, like not rough, not tough, not gonzo. And after 3 years, you know, they wanted to get more energy, more rough, and they do double anal, one girl with, you know, four guys, and just take over and fuck her for, like, or destroy her.
What the industry told us is also consistent with academic research. A range of studies have found significant levels of aggression in the most popular pornography. For example, it commonly depicts gagging, choking, spanking, and verbal aggression. The aggression in pornography is not random. It's overwhelmingly directed towards women. But the viewer sees more than just that gendered aggression. They also see the performer's response to these acts. Researchers found that almost every incident of aggression in pornography is met with either a neutral or a pleasured or positive response by the target. So the message to the viewer is that girls and women like it when men gag them, choke them, and spank them. Same-sex and trans porn also often conveys many of the very same messages that we see in heterosexual cisgender porn, including messages about gender, power, and aggression, where regardless of the genders of those depicted, we often see a replication of those same dominant and submissive gendered stereotypes. Pornography also commonly pushes the boundaries by depicting social taboos, such as a lack of consent, incest, or childlike themes, in an effort to keep viewers' attention. This mainstreaming of aggressive, taboo-pushing pornography is impacting on young people, which is the third key thing to understand. Pornography is now arguably the most prominent form of sexuality education for many young people. Young people often describe how their sexual experiences are being shaped by the pornography they've seen or that their partners or peers have seen.
So first time I had sex, because I'd watched so much porn, I thought all chicks dig this, all chicks want this done to them, all chicks want it up here, all chicks love it there. So I tried all this stuff and yeah, turned out bad.
Thank you so much.
Influence.
Are you, sorry, you just ended. I'm so sorry, you keep going.
Pornography's influence on the sexual script is putting a lot of pressure on young people.
Like, if you're not okay with being choked and slapped, and these are considered standard sexual acts, that's something that I then think puts a lot of women in that position where if they're not comfortable with those certain things, they're not necessarily totally open about saying that because they don't want to seem like a prude or they don't want to seem like they're boring.
One of the most concerning themes that's emerging in the research about pornography's influence is the increase in sexual strangulation, or what is often referred to as sexual choking. This shift in sexual norms is putting young people's lives at risk.
In my experience, as the receiver of choking, you just kind of have to expect that they'll stop at the right time so you don't actually lose consciousness, but sometimes it gets pretty close.
I've been in situations where I feel like I'm genuinely being like murdered.
Unfortunately, young people are getting their information about sexual strangulation from pornography and from other influences such as social media and their partners and peers, not from medical experts. The medical experts we've interviewed are incredibly concerned about the increase in this practice, and they assert that there's no safe way to choke someone, whether during sex or at any other time. The fourth thing to understand then, connected to that, is that a wide range of studies have found that pornography use is related to violent attitudes and behaviours, particularly towards women. Pornography eroticizes violence against women, and it does so while claiming to offer us sexual liberation. In recent years, there has been a significant rise in sexual abuse of children and young people by other children and young people, and evidence suggests that pornography is playing a role in that rise. Professor Simon Hackett has been involved in reviewing cases of young people with harmful sexual behaviours in the UK.
We've got to a point now where we can't ignore the fact that porn is a key driver for harmful sexual behaviour in childhood. The evidence from children suggests that.
Pornography is a topic that many people would like to go away, but it's not going to go away, and it has become a violence prevention and human rights issue that we can't afford to ignore. So how can we support young people to navigate fantastic, respectful relationships in an age of pornography? I'm going to suggest that there are four broad things that we can do. The first is that we can try to prevent or limit their exposure and access to pornography. This needs to happen at structural or systemic levels through policies such as age verification and safety by design, and also more directly in our roles with young people through filters on modems and devices, time-limited access and supervision. Second, we need to equip and encourage young people to critique what they see when they do see pornography, to develop critical media literacy and digital literacy skills and frameworks. Third, we need to help them develop the skills they need to resist pornography's influence, such as how to respond to peer group pressure to watch it or pressure from an intimate partner to mimic something from pornography. Finally, and I think importantly, we need to inspire young people that relationships and sex can and should be much better than what they see in pornography. So what does all of that mean in practice? It means restricting access in ways I've mentioned. It means that we need to have conversations with young people about pornography in the context of broader conversations about sex, gender, power, media influence, and online safety. That means we need to equip the people who live and work with young people to have those conversations. We need to help our leaders understand these issues and how they can be addressed through policy and practice. And we need to find creative and compelling ways to explore these issues as a society through film and drama and social marketing campaigns. Lots of stakeholders have important roles to play. Governments are responsible for regulation, leadership, and resourcing. Schools have a critical role to play for a range of reasons, including that they contribute to young people's sexuality and relationships education, and sexuality education is an appropriate context for addressing it. Parents are a key group to equip. The community sector has a whole range of important roles to play, and we need to tailor our efforts so they make sense to and meet the needs of the communities they're designed for. We also need to support vulnerable young people, such as young people in out-of-home care and youth justice facilities or victim survivors of sexual assault. Our website, itstimewetalk.com, includes information and resources for young people, parents, schools and community organisations. And we also have a campaign about sexual strangulation called Breathless, breathlesscampaign.com. Thank you again to the organisers. It's a pleasure to meet with you.
Thank you so much, Marie Crabb from Australia. We are delightful. It was very, very, very nice to have you here. Our next speaker is Dr. Alma Burbnell, a lecturer at Griffith University, Australia, specializing in surveillance technologies and their impact on privacy and human rights. She holds a PhD in criminology and serves on the Australian Privacy Foundation Surveillance Committee. Let's give her a warm welcome.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. Are you able to hear me okay?
Yes, we are.
Perfect. I'm just requesting a sharing of the presentation, so sharing rights for the presentation, if you could please grant them. And I'll pop in to say hi. But I might keep my video off as I present, because just to make sure that the internet speed is all right as I'm traveling at the moment. So while you're allowing those sharing rights, I'm also sharing the paper that has now been published on which I will be presenting the very brief presentation on today. I think the error that I'm getting, Louisa, is that there's multiple presenters who have been granted the sharing access. So it might be the case you might need to turn off the sharing for someone to turn it on for me.
We are trying to figure it out. Just give us a minute, okay?
No problem.
I'll go out and come back in again, Louisa, and then
Okay.
I'll drop out from being host.
All right, okay. Peter, was it possible to make her a co-host? Oswald, are you there? Yeah, and it's not possible for you to share your screen still, right?
Yes, unfortunately not. It says that the host isn't allowing multiple presenter sharing for this meeting.
Okay, so do you have a lot of slides?
I don't have that many slides. Perhaps I can present without them.
I could try to help you with that. Maybe I could try to share your slides.
Sure. I sent you a link, Louisa, via private chat. See if that opens up for you.
Just a minute. It's not working because it seems that I have to have an account from your university, something like that.
Yeah, okay. Let me try one more. Look, third time is the charm. I'm going to share the file that you might be able to open. Just try for another minute. If it doesn't work, I'll just start presenting and let's see. Sometimes magic happens as we can go. Tatiana is suggesting that there is a setting where you can allow multiple sharing.
Yeah, the point is that I'm not a host, I'm a co-host, so I have some restrictions here as well. So I'm not able to change it for everyone. I'm really sorry about that. And could you try sending me via email. Maybe it's easier for me to open the PowerPoint.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's gone through you now via Zoom message as well. So just let me know when that does.
Okay, so the PowerPoint presentation is logged into a Microsoft online account that is directly linked to your university. It seems that I don't have the ability to open it from here. That's the point. You see? Give us just 2 more minutes. Oh, it seems that now I am able to. Okay, so you are co-host now. See if you can, if you're able to share.
There you go. Perfect.
Thank you so much. Sorry about that. It's good that we are not running out of time.
Technology only fails when we need to use it. So thank you so much for everyone for organizing this meeting. I was very lucky that I'm traveling at the moment on the other side of Australia in Perth. So then it's not too late. So my brain is still working. So I'm very happy to be with you on this auspicious time. Today, I wanted to do a presentation on queer activists in China. And considering that this particular event is looking more at the legal frames, I shared already in the chat a paper on which this short presentation is based, which is called The Fish Tank. So very briefly, the idea of The Fish Tank comes from the place of saying that the activists, the queer activists in China are visible to the outside. For example, at UN conferences, China claims that it supports SOGI, sexual and gender diversity in the country. However, in reality, they're visible as in a fish tank. They're visible to the outside. However, they're very much restrained in their everyday activities. For example, when fundraising or when going out to register their organization, there's a lot of things that are not possible. So this paper is co-authored with Professor Sarah E. Davies, also at Griffith University. And a little bit of research context. So in 2021, lots of LGBTQ plus student group accounts on WeChat were censored. So this is comparable to Facebook or Instagram official accounts of such groups being censored out of the blue. And it was a massive wave of censorship that flew through those accounts. Now, it had not happened before. This was a new development, and it came very closely after the closing of Shanghai Pride in 2020, which was a big blow to the community, to the queer community in China. So the premise of this research project and this collection of the data that I'll tell you a little bit more about was that during COVID-19, lots of communities were moving online, much like we are today. And then at the same time, there seems to be an increasing amount of censorship also happening online. So we really wanted to understand the dynamics of what was happening on the ground and how these dynamics were affecting the activists. Now, in terms of research considerations, this section is very, very important when doing research work in China. Feel free to let me know after the event if you have any questions. I love to talk more about the methods and also the researcher positionality when doing this research. Now, This is very important because China is an authoritarian country and a lot of things, a lot of communications are quite dangerous on particular types of subjects that are considered politically sensitive. And LGBTQ plus activism or queer activism in China is considered a politically sensitive point. Having said all of that, it was very important for us to recruit activists from not just the three big cities in China, such as Beijing, Shanghai, and Guangzhou, but also smaller cities, second and third tier cities. And while also it was very important to recruit activists for our interviews who presented gender diversity, not only sexual diversity. So really making sure the letters on LGBTQ plus are ticked off. And we were very lucky. We were able to get half of people were gender diverse, and then half of people were from outside of Beijing, Shanghai, and Guangzhou. Now, while recruiting in an intersectional way, in an inclusive way, was very important, security had to come first. It's WeChat is a big point of censorship in China, so we could not use WeChat to conduct these interviews online. This was done during COVID time, so we could not travel to China. And also VPNs that allow activists to connect to encrypted communications platforms, VPNs are not legal. So it was really quite tricky. It was made sure that the activists already had the VPNs. And so if we could not ensure that activists had secure VPN connections, we would simply not proceed, unfortunately, with that activist. And we had some rules about not being the activists already having the VPN in place, so we're not convincing them to do it, so that we could make sure they knew it was safe for them. Now, we ended up with actually 26 interviews. And a good balance. They presented a variety of different provinces in China, which is quite rare in research like this. So it's really a lot of thought went into recruitment. And we used a theory base of social sorting by David Lyon. Now, perhaps this is a little bit outside of your area of research for many of you attending, but the social theory comes from surveillance studies. And it is a well-known theory in that particular field. I want to tell you a little bit more about what is really relevant to laws. So the very first interview actually was trying to understand digital censorship. Okay, we're starting with the premise that digital environments are increasingly restrained. But the very first interview that we ran revealed that it was only partially about censorship. And then our participants said, one of them said that, oh, in the past, there were only certain kinds of keywords that would be banned, but now there's different kinds of related keywords. They can sense the account, they can censor the account, they're automate can be automatically blocked. And it was also clear that WeChat made this information known to the government. Now, we knew all of that. We knew that there was digital censorship, but there was more. The first interviewee said, I feel like I'm in my fish tank. That's the name of the article. I feel like I'm a goldfish being held by the government or the party. And the government or the party saying, I don't need many, just a few, right? Just for show, making sure that they're still alive. So, what this really crucial interview revealed that sure, there was censorship, but there was so much more happening. And the research, we went ahead and drew together, if you open the article, it is open access. In table two, you will be able to see a list of different laws, policies, and regulations that the activists outline that we're sorting the activists through socially sorting. So none of these policies was saying the word queer people are bad or LGBTQ plus activism is not legal. However, they were adding direct and indirect pressure onto the activists. So for example, one instance, one example is the two-child policy. So two-child policy was a law that which changed the one-child policy, which allowed people to have two children. Now, queer activists felt quite pressured by that because it is quite difficult for queer people in China to have children at this time. And the party actually pressured the many party members in China, especially women, by calling them sometimes on the phone and saying, hey, you're 25 and you're not married yet. You should really be going out and trying to find a husband, trying to get married and have kids as soon as possible. So really quite weird, quite direct pressure coming directly from the party and adding pressure on queer, especially women in this instance. Now, other laws directly targeted NGOs. So a big example of that is the 2017 Overseas NGO Management Law. The Overseas NGO Management Law highlighted only several areas in which overseas NGOs could work. And so that meant that in 2017, starting that year, overseas NGOs could not work with sexual and gender diversity topics anymore. Many of them have had to close down. They could also not support the local organization. That had been one of the lifelines for many organizations in China, and that was a particularly heavy blow. Now, in between 2017 and 2021, there were a number of laws that were going through regarding fundraising. So I guess we can all agree that, you know, fundraising for charities should be regulated. You want to make sure that people who are fundraising for charities are not really just fundraising and putting the money in their pocket, but rather putting that money into their organization. However, a number of these laws, which again, you can look at in full in the table two of the article, they really outlined that an organization that wanted to fundraise had to be a registered organization. And now, can you guess if it's easy or difficult for a queer organization to register in China? It is very difficult. So these organizations would go to a local bureau and say, hey, this law, you know, I want to fundraise, I should register my organization. And at the local office of government affairs, the officials there would ask, great, what does your organization do? They say gender and sexual diversity activism. And they say, laugh in their face, yeah, absolutely not. We can't even consider this, right? So on paper, this looked like a very appropriate way of managing the charity sector. But in reality, on the ground, it made it very fish tanky. It made it very difficult for these organizations to do anything. So because without overseas NGO support, without being able to fundraise domestically, it leaves the organizations with no money, no access to money. Right. And then other pressures such as social media censorship, which is colloquially known on the ground as the Sissy ban, also affected organizations where this particular law has to do with censorship of content, specifically of content that is queer online, and specifically as it refers to men. So gay and bisexual men and trans women reported seeing most censorship, most repression based off of this ban. And look, I think these are the most important things when it comes to law and legality and how law interacts. This is the most important slide and table that I can share with you folks, because this is a very unique situation where we see these human rights being represented one way internationally, and then domestically, a number of different laws are put together in a way where activists are not able to find any breathing space. Now, in the article, we also talk more about the implementation of this theory that we discuss, and we talk about online space monitoring, some benefits of online trolling. We talk about police monitoring and harassment. These laws made it okay for police to monitor and harass activists. And what it has resulted, of course, is activists really unable to move to conduct any sort of things that their organizations, groups were able to do before. So resulting in self-censorship, resulting in minority stress. So feeling really like a minority in the country and having increased stress because of that. And trying just to survive as a group, as a community. Now, I will stop there and thank you. I believe I am at time. Feel free to reach out to me via email. I'd love to continue these conversations. And if you have any questions at all, would love to connect.
Dr. Bernot, thank you so much for your presentation. We'll definitely get in touch with you via email with further questions. And I now would like to invite Professor Edna Hogeman to introduce our next speaker.
Hi, everyone. Our next presentation is about climate migration legal trends. I have great honor in introducing Professor Tatiana Dracock-Hurst. She's Doctor of Science of Law, Professor at the Department of Theory of Law and Constitutionalism, West Ukrainian National University. Welcome, Professor Tatiana. The floor is yours. Yeah.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm very pleased to see you, Dr. Edna Hochman, and also Osvaldo Lima Jr. I'm really, really pleased to see you online personally. And also I'm saying hi from Ukraine. And maybe in the nearest future, we will manage to see each other in person again. But now I would like to share also my presentation, just a sec, with you. And let's start. I won't be so brief, but also I won't just speak too long. So in the middle. So I hope so that you can see what I'm sharing. And now what I'm just wanted to share with you is my own legal analysis. So like nowadays, despite of growing number of people fleeing their lands due to consequences of climate change, and neither climate refugee nor environmental migrants and environmentally displaced persons are recognized under international law. So nowadays we have such kind of tendency that if they are not acknowledged under international law because they are not covered by the 1951 Refugee Convention. That's what we have nowadays. I hope that you can see. You can see that there is a lack of legal recognition for such type of refugees. So when we are talking about the Refugee Convention, it is basically relating to the status of refugees serves as the legal framework regulating those seeking asylum in another country. Since it requires proof of persecution, it also cannot be applied to environmentally displaced persons as such. Alongside, we also have the task force on displacement established under the Paris Agreement addresses migration and human mobility concerning climate change. But it also provides recommendations for integrated approaches to prevent, minimize, and address displacement related to the adverse effects of climate change. And however, there is no definitive terminology specifically for climate refugees. And also, Experts warned that in the case of small island nations and poor countries like Bangladesh, for instance, where over 200 million people live less than 1 meter above sea level, defining climate migration or environmentally displaced person as part of international refugee regulation is an urgent issue requiring decisive action. And also during the NATO Leaders Summit that is held annually, and last year, the issue of combating climate change was discussed for the first time. And this highlighted the current dangers of climate change, particularly in the nearest future. So in 2030 agenda, NATO just states that will enhance awareness by monitoring climate change more closely and will invest in better research, data sharing, and analysis. This will accelerate its adaptation to continue functioning under any conditions, so including extreme heat and cold, rising sea levels, and natural disasters. So as we may see, I just need to click. What we have nowadays when we are talking about the scope of protection. So the central question regarding the legal protection of those displaced for reasons related to climate change concerns the temporal scope of such protection. How far in the future should we look when accessing claims for protection? The first question. Is it sufficient to know that the place will become uninhabitable to live in 10 years? And is a more immediate risk required? And or is the time inherently an arbitrary criterion? So we have a lot of questions, but there are no like similar answers to them, yes? So in determining a reasonable there's hold, established standards of proof in refugee law and human rights law must be utilized. So for international protection to be granted, Article 1 of the Refugee Convention requires that the refugee has a well-founded fear of being persecuted, while human rights law protects individuals from deportation if there is a real risk of torture, inhuman or degrading treatment, or arbitrary deprivation of life upon expulsion. So that is why we can say that for individuals displaced due to climate change, meeting that well-founded fear standard under Refugee Convention is likely to be challenging. So it's not clicking. So we have here some utilizing existing legal frameworks. So the first one is the principle refoulement. What exactly does it mean? That consequently the non-refoulement principle just states about real risk tests developed in the context become even more significant. And when we are talking about international law doctrine, which interprets that the foreseeable consequences of deportation constitute the relevant temporal measure for assessing a real risk. For example, we have such kind of legal practice like Sovereign versus the United Kingdom. So if a real risk is reasonably foreseeable, the individual is protected by non-refoulement. So this approach aligns with the well-founded fear standard interpreted as a requirement, as a reasonable possibility or a real chance of persecution. So neither standard specifies precise time frames for the realization. Excuse me, but people are joining and I have to accept their requests. Yes. And when we are talking about the realization of risk, which not includes the concept of imminence. So the decisive criterion is whether any reasonable scenario exists under which individuals will face such risks, warranting then protection from expulsion. So what exactly I'm suggesting in this scope? So we have here like the four main challenges. First of all, it's about Human Rights Committee during the United States and during that exactly specialized agency for protection refugees. So there is no concrete link between climate change and human rights violation. Also, there should be added some additional protocols to this convention. Also, when we are talking about the long-term mitigating and adaptation, unfortunately, not all countries can adapt through their own national levels, and they are not willing to, because we have also three criterions, yes, like the public security, public health, public order, and each country can just not allow to adapt like it is truly into the own national level. And also, if there is a possibility of internal displacement, then they're going to ask, why didn't you try to move inside of the country? Why you want to ask for further protection or asylum in another country? So please do something about that. And we cannot grant you such kind of legal status. And the same when we are talking about international cooperation. So nowadays it's very essential when we are talking about global challenge, because we have to support most vulnerable countries in effects, but also not to forget about the, our own locals, yes, nationals and citizens as well. So issues and what are the solutions from my own, let it maybe say, scholar approach, you may see here. I just want to outline the exact, about talking about this scope of protection, like the temporal scope of protection. So here we have to unify one procedure for all country members of the UN Convention, and also when we are talking about national levels, yes, for further adaptation of those norms and protocols to those conventions. And then we will just feel that we are in the same balance according to the concrete criterion, especially when we can outline that there is a real risk. It also just can be related to a person, and also it can be like a harm to a person. And here also we can just maybe a little bit predict foreseeable consequences of climate change that we're going to see within 10 or 15 years for sure. And just to conclude, why it's not clicking? Yes. I want to pay attention to the role of international community. Here we already talked about 17 sustainable, yes, goals till 2030. Also, we are talking about human rights law, but somehow, some way we have to communicate, and more developed countries just have to interact with less developed countries under their own national level, but through the international level, because it's a global question. And just to conclude, policymakers should focus not only on mitigating the risk of climate change, but also on implementing sensible long-term migration policies and planned relocation strategies for the particularly vulnerable communities. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Tatiana. I would like to invite Professor Osvaldo to introduce our next speaker.
Thank you very much, Luisa. Very happy to see you, Tatiana, and let's move on. I'm pleased to introduce now my dear friend a bigger partnership, Professor Niasha Ambote. Professor Mbote is founder of the new field of apartheid studies. He is associate professor and head of the Department of Communication Science at the University of Free State in Bloemfontein. His topic today is mapping South Africa 10th province and Brazil 27th Estado in the apartheid study frameworks. It's a very interesting issue. I give the floor so to my dear friend, Professor Nyasha Mbote. You're welcome, Professor.
Thank you, Osvaldo. And thank you, Edna, and all the colleagues today. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, Professor. You're
awesome. Out. All right. Please let me know if my screen is sharing.
It is sharing, yes.
Awesome. Thank you, Louisa. So my talk today is about what I call the 10th province, or you can say the 27th Estado. You can apply it anywhere to any country, whether it's India or the United States. If the United States has 50 states, you can look for the 51st state. If Brazil has 27 states, you look for the 26 states, you look for the 27th. If South Africa has 9 provinces, you look for the 10th one. So what do I mean by this? I'm trying here to talk about an analytical approach to understanding harm. So my work in apartheid studies, my book was published last year, which outlines this approach to understanding harm, injustice, oppression. It was published by Africa World Press. You can look it up online. It's available on Amazon. You can order it for your university libraries. But in this book, I lay out an approach to understanding the persistence of harm, right? The problem, even with human rights, is not necessarily that human rights abuses are a problem per se. The issue with human rights abuses is that they persist. You see, they keep happening again and again and again and again. So the issue is with the persistence, because if something could happen and then would fix it, it would not be a human rights issue. We would not be sitting here today. We would not be having a conference. The real reason we're having a conference is because these problems don't go away. So I'm okay with having a problem that goes away, because then it means we can move on. But I have a problem with moving on when a problem is still there. So my work talks about persistence, the persistence of harm, not harm on its own. So I don't want to talk about injustice on its own. I don't want to talk about human rights abuses on their own. I don't want to talk about poverty and inequality on their own. I want to isolate a specific variable, which is that the problem is not poverty itself. It's the fact that poverty goes on and on and on and on. And that for me is a dilemma for human rights scholars, for lawyers, for people who study jurisprudence, because we all have inalienable human rights. But the war in Gaza is going on. The things that have been going on in Haiti are still going on. In the Congo, in the favelas, in the barrios, in Garavi, in Mumbai, in Khayelitsha, in Cape Town. So it is not for lack of legal precepts. It is not for lack of human rights. We know what our human rights are, but human rights abuses go on anyway. Why? How do they keep happening again and again and again. So my work tries to look and to theorize the persistence of harm and injustice. So for instance, if you look at that map of Brazil on the left, you can see the 26 states, the federative states of Brazil. If you look at the map on the right, you can see the 9 provinces of South Africa. And my argument is that, in fact, if you think about it in terms of the persistence of harm, analytically, if you look for first principles, South Africa has a 10th province. Brazil has a 27th estado. The United States has a 51st state, and so on. Because the 10th province or the 27th state in Brazil or the 10th province in South Africa is not a place. You can't go to it. You don't have to visit that place. It's a set of outcomes. It's things that happen to you. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter who you are with. It's a little bit like when I'm in South Africa, I have my white friends and we go into a supermarket or into a restaurant, and the supermarket security guard starts to follow me around in the shop. They don't follow my friend. They follow me because I'm a darker skin looking person. I'm a black person. And so they suspect me of not being up to any good in that shop. They suspect me of wanting to steal. So the security guard starts following me around. And I say to my friend, look, you and I are friends. We're good friends. We love each other. We live in a non-racial country. Why is it this specific outcome keeps happening only to me? There has to be an algorithm. Why is the security guard following me and not you? Even though you and I are friends, even though after 1994, South Africa is a non-racial country and we are all supposed to be equal citizens. You can take that example to when there is flooding in South Africa. The floods affect disproportionately poor people. What is the algorithm that says, you have a natural disaster, but you always know after the natural disaster, whether it's an earthquake, whether it's floods, whether it's fire, whatever it is, the disaster is going to disproportionately affect certain people. How? How does it happen? So you can cure it. Whatever disaster or pandemic, COVID, the Zika virus, crime, it disproportionately affects certain people again and again and again and again. So my argument is that the 10th province is an analytical space we need to understand this distinction. That I'm good friends with Osvaldo, but when the police come, I'm the one who gets affected disproportionately. That I have good friends and we're sitting together at the restaurants and we're eating, and the only person that they suspect of stealing there is this person or that person or such and such a person. Why do these things keep happening to certain people? So for me, the 10th province or the 27th estado or the 51st state in the United States is not a place. It's a set of outcomes. It's a set of persistent outcomes. Things that should end, but do not. So my question today, the question that I'd like to pose is, how is it that harm, poverty, inequality, and injustice persist side by side with inalienable human rights? The human rights are there. All of us have inalienable human rights. And yet we know that harm continues. Look at how, you know, I live in South Africa and people love rugby. In Brazil, I know people love football. The war in Gaza is not going to stop the Primeira Liga from continuing. It did not stop the World Cup of rugby. It did not stop the Cricket World Cup in the Caribbean. It went on. It almost happened side by side. It's almost like cricket can continue, rugby, football can continue. Life goes on. So I'm fascinated by this. How is it football continues? You don't stop the league. You don't lock down the country simply because children are dying in Gaza, simply because there's war in the world, simply because there's poverty in the world. So I'm fascinated by that. The answer for me is that we have already priced in persistent harm in our daily lives, that we know that some people will suffer in certain ways. Look at the Sustainable Development Goals. Initially, they started in 2000 as the Millennium Development Goals. Then they didn't achieve them by 2015. They changed them to SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. Then they said they are going to be achieved in 2030. Now they've said, no, they are not going to be achieved in 2030. They've pushed them to 2092. I mean, who's going to be alive in 2092? It looks like some people can live that long without dignity. So who are these people? Right? We say it's too bad, but we go on with our dinners. Who are these people we accept that they can live until 2092 like this? But there are some people we accept, we price in that, look, human rights abuses are bad, but until 2030, some people will have to live like this. It's tough, we're sorry, we have solidarity, but people will have to live like that. So look at poverty. We have accepted that poverty is going to be there maybe until 2030, maybe until 2060, maybe until 2092. But who are the people who must live in poverty? Why have we already priced in that some Brazilians, some South Africans, some Americans will have to live like this for the next foreseeable future? So my work talks about this pricing in that we do in our institutions, in our laws. Even the law prices that backlog. We don't deal with all the cases that are there. We don't deal with justice in a timely manner because we've already priced in that some people will live without justice for as long as possible until we get there, until we deal with those issues. So I'm gonna stop there in a moment, but this is what my work is about. I'm trying to understand analytically this space where we have the laws, we have the jurisprudence, we have the case law, we have the police, we have the executive and the judiciary and the legislature, and yet people continue to live like this, right? This is a place called Imizamoyetu in Cape Town. It's been like this for 30 years, since the 80s. And this place is side by side with another place called Hout Bay, which is one of the richest in Cape Town. This is one of the poorest, side by side with one of the richest. Life goes on. So you have already priced in that you are going to have these slums for as long as possible. This is Rocinha in Brazil, in Rio. You can see in the background, the South Zone. So one of the most poorest, where people live on top of each other, is just next door to one of the richest. There's a pricing in that, look, this is going to be there for the foreseeable future. Even the Bible, for those of us here who are Christians, it says the poor are always going to be with us. I don't know what verse that is. I've forgotten my biblical knowledge. But it even accepts that the poor are always going to be with us. Who are these people whom we've priced in, whom we've accepted that they are going to be like that? This is Dharavi in Mumbai, you know, one of the biggest slums in the world. You can go on and on and on. But my argument is we need to think deeper about the problem of what I'm calling the 10th province, a space which will help us to understand how is it, even when other people live in poverty, in inequality, with human rights abuses, how does life go on? Why does life go on? Why does the sun rise in the east and set in the west? Life just goes on. And my argument is it looks like we price in the fact that people who have often lived like that can live a little bit more like that for one more day, one more week, one more month, one more year, 10 more years. We've priced in that people who have lived with inequality can live a little bit more with it. And 1 year becomes 10 years, and 10 years become 50 years. Because how long have favelas been around in Rio? How long have slums been there in India, in South Africa? 30 years, 50 years. What part of our institutional understanding accepts that people can live a little bit more like that? One more day, one more week, one more year, 10 more years, 50 more years. So what I'm doing in closing is a provocation. I'm doing a provocation to say, how is it that we have inalienable human rights? We have laws. We have the judiciary. We have the law. We have the police. We have all of these aspects of how we try to preserve human dignity. And yet these laws themselves seem to have prized in the fact that we are only going to deal with this case from time to time. The others will deal with them later. The other issues will do them with them next year. will deal with poverty in 20 years' time. That's when maybe everyone will be able to live with dignity, to live decent lives, and so on. So for me, there's a fascination with this attempt to understand how life goes on while human rights abuses, poverty, inequality is also going on at the same time. So I'm not giving answers. I'm simply putting a provocation out there about how is it that life goes on? What enables life to go on? Even when we know these problems themselves have not gone away. Why do we sleep with ourselves at night? How is it our dinners taste the same way? Our food tastes the same way as it always did? And life basically goes on. Thank you, colleagues. I'll stop there today.
Thank you very much, Professor Nyasha. I'll now pass the floor to Professor Edna, who will introduce our next speaker.
Well, thank you so much, Professor Bott. Great pleasure being with you today. And our next speaker is a great friend of mine, Professor Antonietta Elia from Italy. She's BSIA, now resident fellow and member of the Berkeley Center for Comparative Equality and Non-Discrimination Law. It's a special pleasure to introduce you. Welcome, my dear Professor Antonietta Elia.
Muito obrigada, professora Ogerman, pelo convite. Muito obrigado, professor Osvaldo.
She speaks Portuguese.
sei que a apresentação vai ser em inglês, mas queria agradecer e estou muito contente pela honra de estar convosco um ano mais na segunda edição e desculpa, a inteligência artificial pede se quero trocar no idioma a plataforma. Estava a dizer, é um gosto estar convosco todos. Muitos parabéns pela organização. Não é nada fácil juntar tantos colegas online. Assim que muito obrigada por estar aqui.
I will ask Mr. Mbodi to close his slides for you to start.
Oh,
please, Professor Nyasha, turn off your slides, please. Okay, Professor Antonietta.
May I start? Yeah.
Yes, I think so.
Okay, thank you. So just let me know how many time I have at my disposal, please.
15 minutes, okay?
Okay, 15 minutes. Oof. This is a very hard deal to do, but I will try. So today, my focus is on the regulation of artificial intelligence in the way to assess, or better said, limit the impact that the use, the creation, and the generation of new artificial intelligence tools can have over human rights, rule of law, and democracy. Of course, it is a need to find a global agreement, because the development of new technologies is a global issue. So it needs, in my view, a global answer from a legal point of view, and consequently from a policy, public policy guidelines in the execution of such rules. But what I would like to introduce today is a really short sketch, due to time constraint, about the very recently approved Council of Europe Framework Convention on Artificial Intelligence and Human Rights, Democracy and Rule of Law. It is the first until now international convention approved over these, the first tentative to regulate artificial intelligence in line with human rights standards and its implementation. Someone can ask, okay, it's coming from Council of Europe, so it means that it is only open to Council of Europe member states. That's not the case, because the Council of Europe, in its statute, at Article 1, among its aims, affirm the aim to promote international cooperation also through the adoption of international treaties in line with UN principles and values. And open such conventions. It is not the first time that the Council of Europe actually adopted global conventions, not just Council of Europe limited ones. But this is of importance, of particular importance, because it is the first one trying to give a global sketch over the need to assess limits to the use and development of artificial intelligence. And of course, on the basis of that, such convention has been opened last 5th September of the current year to the signature and the adoption to all interested states of the global community. It is important to underline that over the text, as a little reference of the over the methodology of the adoption of the content, the text, it's quite short. If you want, it's available online on the page of the Council of Europe Rule of Law Directorate General, but also on the general page of the documents with the Council of Europe Treaty Series number 225. And what is interesting to note is it's relatively short because it is no more of 36 articles. It's not so much. So from some certain point of view, it's quite synthetically. But the first question is about methodology. The adoption of the content has been practical internally to the Council of Europe. And when I say internally, I don't mean that only member states of the Council of Europe work it on. It means that worked over the text a series of institutions of the Council of Europe, like the Human Rights Commissioner, like committee, the special committee created over artificial, created in charge to make a study on the feasibility of such a convention, and so on. So all internal institution. Of course, also states observers before the Council of Europe have been called to contribute, and we have also contribution of the European Union and of the United States contribution to the text. And we will see some, unfortunately, effect of the introduction and the participation of different stakeholders and different states over the text, because as we know, a treaty after all is a compromise of multiple interests. And unfortunately, it is also the case in the convention. So Canada also contributed to the text and so on. But then I must say personally, of course, I forgot to say that all the opinions expressed over the convention are mine. In my personal capacity, do not imply the responsibility of the Council of Europe at any time. And it is a great effort, without any doubt, but there are some, at least perplexity or negative impact. Because you know that the artificial intelligence has been going to is going to be used increasingly in many sectors of the daily life, in the civil and military measures, and the most important is used to limit the border access of states, to control people on the move at border in many states, especially in Europe. And it is used also for example, to stereotyping with facial recognition, the racial, the gender, and so on. So it means that it means that there are quite problematic issues to be taken into account that, in my opinion, the framework convention exclude, in some cases expressly, from the regulation. It is the case, for example, of the national security exception and the military exception, and the security control exception. And this is just one of the first objections I have, which is underlined into the scope. So the limitation of the same convention, limitation of the scope and application, it is enshrined at Article 3 of the convention. And the security exception is set forth in at paragraph 2 of the same convention, Article 3. And I read, a party shall not be required to apply this convention to activities within the life cycle of artificial intelligence systems related to the protection of its national security interest, with the understanding that such activities are conducted in a manner consistent with and applicable international law, including international human rights law obligations, and with respect for its democratic institutions and processes. So you see that in few sentences, there is the exclusion or the lack of courage, if you want, to regulate or try to find an agreement about regulation of the security, national security exception. In the last sentence of the same subparagraph, there is a sort of state presumption of accomplishment with human rights law, international human rights law, a presumption of application. Something that is very, I can say, quite diffused in the framework of Europe and Council of Europe and European Union. Let me open a window about that for who is not so familiar with Council of Europe. Actually, when I'm mentioning Council of Europe, I'm talking about a different international organization, not European Union, which is a separate one. and not of the Council of European Union, which is an institution of the European Union. So the Council of Europe is also a European, more extended in terms of members, but it's also a European organization for regional cooperation with the power authorization to extend the open cooperation to also external member states. External states to the same Council of Europe. So, and this is the security exception. To me, it's a very lack, a missed opportunity to make sensitive to limit artificial intelligence. Why? And what is the impact that such kind of exception can have? As I said, artificial intelligence mechanisms are increasingly used, especially for border control. So it means that in case of migration and people on the move, many states, especially Europe, but unfortunately not only, when they say that migration is a national security question, they can use whatever they want, because there is no exception, there is no limit to such exception. Just to say the arrival of migrants is a national security issue, I can use everything according to such article. This is a very interesting point. But you know that I'm an optimistic person, and I try to interpret in some way. This is a very first initial step. The convention is still is still pending for ratification and so on. It's very recent. So what I'm trying to do is make a reasoning de jure condendo, and what it is possible to see in the future, in the near future, actually. So there is a step, a very interesting step in the preamble, and also in the general provision, in the general provisions, where it is said that the same convention can be integrated by several guidance framework document in order as much as needed in order to clarify the content, in order to integrate in accordance with the development of artificial intelligence and new technologies the same text. This is really interesting because very recently, 2 days ago, the Council of Europe just adopted the first document of such kind, which is dedicated to try to, at least to try to offer a methodology for the risk and impact assessment of artificial intelligence systems from the point of view of human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. The so-called Uderia methodology, Huderia methodology. Of course, the institution in charge of such kind of adoption of study and documents with the aim to clarify in some way a specific aspect of the convention is into the hands of the Committee on Artificial Intelligence, which is a specific institution created in the framework of the Council of Europe, and which has been in charge, as I said, of the state of accessibility of the text of the convention, and also to coordinate all the contribution of the coming over the text from the other internal institution of the Council of Europe and create a feasible text to submit to the signature. So it is interesting, the document has been adopted very recently on 28 November. But what is interesting is that the document said exactly the contrary. So it should not be considered as integrative of the convention, neither as explanatory one, like a sort of, okay, we give you a scientific document, then do whatever you want. But if I think to international law and to, for example, Article 32 of the Statute of the International Court of Justice, all related documents to a convention must consider useful to the interpretation. So what is the reason to say expressly in such kind of guidance, okay, we published the guidance, but it is not related, neither legally binding to the convention? It's a sort of, okay, I do a step ahead and I make a step ahead and two behind, two back, sorry. It is interesting from my point of view. Unfortunately, we have not too much time to go further over the guidance, but let me just make another reference to another negative point, because in the same Article 3 of the Convention, at subparagraph 4, what is underlined in the difference is at paragraph 2, the security exception, national security exception. At paragraph 4, there is just the one sentence dedicated to national defense exception. So you see a sort of implicit authorization to do whatever they want, because every state is free to decide what is an issue of national defense or not. And we are assisting to that nowadays with many decisions against international law and just related to political interest, better said. So without entry into the merit. That said, let me at least give a good remark, concluding my intervention, because I think I went out of the time limit. I'm sorry. It is true that the chapter third tried to make an effort for the first time to list what it defines like principles related to activities within the life cycle, so the entire life cycle of AI, of artificial intelligence systems, since the creation, the development, the self-generation of certain mechanisms, and so on. And there is a very, not long, but at least a sort of tentative to put such principle like human dignity, individual autonomy, transparency and oversight, accountability and responsibility, equality and non-discrimination, privacy and personal data protection. It is really extensive in such way. And then chapter four, and I conclude, is dedicated to remedies, but it's really short because there are just two articles, 14 and 15, dedicated to remedies. Instead, the already mentioned guiding principle over impact assessment should be related to chapter 5 of the convention and article 16 on risk and impact management framework. As you say, that there is a sort of contradiction between the guiding principle saying we are related, but we are not explanatory, neither a legal binding instrument of the convention, when there is a precise recall inside the convention. But that said, and I conclude really, I had the opportunity to say in other sessions, saying in other places, this is still a first tentative to find an agreement at global level over the limitation of artificial intelligence in the entire life cycle of artificial intelligence in terms of protection of human rights, rule of law, and democracy. But we need to make more steps ahead. Thank you very much for your attention to have me today.
Thank you, Professor Antonieta Elia. We are delighted to introduce Gabrielle Bordeaux, a Canadian scholar focusing on women, democracy, and power. Her work has supported democracy building initiatives in over 60 countries for UN agencies, foreign ministries, and international nonprofits. Welcome, Professor Bordeaux.
Thank you so much. And thank you for having me here. I will endeavor to keep my remarks to just the 10 minutes assigned. So I'll be speaking today about my research work on the topic of online violence, disinformation, and women's public leadership, more specifically the issue of online violence against women in politics. So women candidates, women who hold office, women in other leadership positions in their communities, in their states, and how that affects things. So this is part of a broader research project, which you can see on the screen before you. This is the bigger angle today, but I will limit my comments to just the definitions and concept, as well as some of the empirical findings from comparative research in about a dozen international contexts. So starting with definitions and understanding what is the nature of this problem, I know that this has been discussed already at some length, but the way that I've approached this question is by understanding violence against women in politics, VAWP, also known by a terrible acronym, tech-facilitated gender-based violence, TFGBV, with a P for politics online, understanding it in a two-part way. First, seeing direct criminal acts, so explicit threats, criminal harassment, cyberstalking, things that can be legislated, prosecuted, and held accountable under various domestic legal frameworks, as well as international human rights frameworks. And then kind of a softer side, if you will, but nonetheless damaging, of harmful speech. So abusive, threatening, shaming, demeaning, rhetoric, incivility, also known as, and disinformation. Right. So I understand that this specific type of violence against women exists on a spectrum, understanding that all violence is ranging from psychological, non-physical to physical, and that it grows in different levels of intensity. So the lowest level of intensity being incivility and oftentimes humorous remarks, shifting into information disorders. So misinformation, disinformation, information that is being manipulated for intentional purposes of either preventing a woman from holding office, of leaving office, or otherwise persuading her political participation. Beyond that point, it becomes more intense and more explicit in its misogynistic tones. So hate speech being the most specific form of inciting forms of violence, and then actual incitations to enact that violence. On this slide, we see how this fits into understandings of the concepts of violence against women in politics, and how we can identify the gendered nature of these different forms of violence. So across all of these different forms, we see different forms of gender-specific issues, whether it is sexual-related violence, attacking women based on their traditional roles or things like this. But it's only in the more intense forms of the violence, the hate speech and the threats of sexual violence, that we see motives appear that are specifically gendered and misogynistic. Meanwhile, all of these different forms will have different gendered impacts, ranging again from preventing women from running for office, changing their votes, changing their participation, or leaving office more early. We know that this is a type of violence that has a variety of different measurement impacts as well, that intensity is very challenging, especially for measuring in a human rights framework because of the volume. We're talking about thousands, if not more, of perpetrators, of the speed the messages go out at the duration. We see incidents that last multiple years and whatnot. However, we do know just how extensive the problem is. I won't repeat this here because I'm sure that it has been covered and will be covered by colleagues here. I'd like to pass directly to talk briefly about some of the findings of empirical studies on this topic. The notion being that it is essential to understand the commonalities as well as the differences in this specific form of gendered violence, form of political violence, in order to enhance and develop human rights frameworks around them, as well as frameworks governing AI issues. So in brief, 12 different countries using similar but not identical methodologies. Much of this was done in collaboration with nonprofit organizations. And so the methodology was adopted in different countries, including Afghanistan, Bougainville, Ecuador, Haiti, Myanmar, Papua New Guinea, Sri Lanka, Somalia, Syria, Ukraine, Zambia, and Zimbabwe, over primarily from 2017 to 2020. And you see some of the organizations here. It has also been supplemented with findings from other regional and country-specific studies. So very briefly, talking about what some of these findings look like, what is this problem and what does it look like in different parts of the world? Some of the contours. So first and foremost, we know that this is a globally pervasive problem. There's nowhere that we have looked that we have not found it. However, it looks very different according to different cultural contexts, which is why I'm saying here culturally specific. It is reflecting the cultural norms and the values and the tropes in each of the countries where it occurs. Here you see word clouds from some of the different studies. And, you know, this can be, to take an example, looking at Haiti, for example, where terminology around witchcraft was more present in the tweets and the Facebook posts that we were seeing against political women, whereas looking at Muslim majority countries, the vocabulary is very different, often more traditional, religious based, also involving more animal imagery, which is a severe form of insult in many of these contexts. So it looks different each place it happens, but it is occurring and is having very profound impacts on women's participation. Also noting that viral incidents or violent incidents against women tend to go viral more often, and this is because they have a real shock value. The internet and social media being the prime location for clickbait, for shock value, sensational content. Content targeting women in this way tended to spike more than similar content against men. That's an example from Zimbabwe that you see on the screen. We saw that women were experiencing higher intensity aggression in many ways, and that was both more threats around death and rape, as well as intensities measured in volume, speed, and duration. I'm going to put an image up. It's very offensive. I'll just to warn you about that. I will flip through it quickly also because I realize time is advancing. But this is from the New York Times, but it shows a bit of the intensity. We find that this problem is tied to political events. Also, it follows a news cycle. It follows election cycles. But also that women were experiencing very sustained impacts of this. It might be triggered by a specific political event, but years later, many women were still experiencing the echoes of it or a lower level of sustained harassment or abuse online, following the similar messaging around that which triggered it. We're able to locate it somewhat. It has a specific geography in most of the countries we looked at. It was originating in the major cities and then spreading outwards, often with traditional media, radio, television, newspaper. And also, of course, it's not limited to national borders. It follows diaspora groups in particular, as you see here from Zimbabwe, obviously most intense in Zimbabwe itself, but also in other parts of the world. And traceable even down to, you know, quite specific geographic levels. And so New York and California pictured here are large diaspora centers. Candidate profile is an impact. We see that higher level, higher visibility women are often receiving much greater quantities of this, but that it does shake down to lower levels, and often women who are running for local office or you know, regional offices do face it equally and are often much less prepared to deal with it. They have fewer staff, they might have less tech capacity and so forth. So the intensity does vary according to how publicly visible they are, but preparedness does as well. Finally, there are a number of institutional factors that we see influencing this, whether it was the electoral system design, first past the post versus proportional representation systems, as well as quota design. Essentially, the more confrontational systems are, it tends to relate to more backlash factors. I can discuss that at more length, but I am drawing at the end of my time. So I'll just end on perhaps a positive note, just choosing one of the impacts and trends of the many that we found. Most commonly, we associate this type of violence as having a chilling effect, turning people off of politics, pushing them out of political spaces. But in fact, we find that it's mixed. Certainly, that is a major impact of it, but it is also driving awareness and change. It is a very visible form of violence, and it is only making people angrier and more eager to step up and to do something about it. So we do see it having a mobilizing effect as well in some contexts. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Bordal. Our next speaker is Pierre-Guillaume Prigent. He holds a PhD in sociology and teaches at the University of Western Brittany in France. His research focuses on gender-based violence, particularly post-separation domestic violence and coercive control. The floor is yours, Professor Prigent.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so I'm trying to share my PowerPoint, so okay. Hello, everyone. Today, we'll speak to you about the violation of the human rights of women victims of domestic violence in the context of child residence proceedings in France. So to do that, I will first begin with defining some of the terms. I define domestic violence as a physically, sexually, and psychologically harmful behaviors in the context of marriage, cohabitation, or any other form of union, as well as emotional and economic abuse and controlling behaviors. And I must recall that violence against women is considered as a violation of human rights by international organizations such as United Nations and the Council of Europe. To make the research, I used the social and systemic entrapment framework, which is defined as to consider the restrictions placed on a victim's survivor's autonomy and agency by their partners, abusive and controlling behaviors, and by broader systemic patterns of harm, which frequently continue even after a victim's survivor leaves their abusive partner. And this term, social entrapment, was coined by a sociologist, which is named James Patashek. It was in 1999, and it involves considering and having a focus on the social isolation, fear, and coercion that men's violence creates in women's lives. It means having an attention to the indifference of powerful institutions to women's suffering, and also the identification of the ways that men's coercive control can be aggravated by structural inequalities of gender, class, and racism. I made research myself and with my colleague Gwen Lacher, which is a PhD student at the University of Western Brittany in sociology too. And we studied the discursive and legal strategies of fathers groups, post-operation abuse and coercive control, and the social use of parental alienation. And all of this together makes us being able to answer the question, which was already asked by Patashek in 1999, how do the courts, and particularly how do the family courts, affect women's ability to resist or escape violence? And to answer that question, we made interviews with survivors. At the moment, we made 14 interviews with 40 women who have 70 children. And it was the interviews based on two studies. The first is my thesis, and I made 20 semi-structured interviews with 20 women. They were conducted between 2013 and 2018 about post-operation abuse and coercive control. And with Gwenola, we made interviews with 20 women between 2017 and 2021 about the social use of the parental alienation. I will define the term after presenting some other results. And in my thesis and in the other interviews we made with Gwenola, we saw that the perpetrator strategy is a coercive control. It's gendered combined tactics of varying intensity depending on the situation. Coercive control is a notion that was termed by coined by the Dubas and the Dubas in 1979, and Evan Stark is popular because he rearticulated this in 2007. And in my thesis, I see there's several strategies: isolation, deprivation of resources, patriarchal control of daily activities, intimidation, devaluation, confusion, overburden of responsibility, and violence. And so how do the family courts have an impact on women's ability to resist or escape violence? In my thesis and in the interviews we made with Gwenola, we see that the women are under pressure to preserve or reestablish the link between the father and his children in the name of joint parental authority. And with the joint parental authority, the aggressor can continue to control the daily activities of the mother and the children. And when the mother denounces violence, and which is also a way of resisting the violence, she is seen as fueling a parental conflict. Violence is reduced as conflict and considered as a shared responsibility. And the most important thing we saw is, and it's been seen for decades in research, it's that there is a confusion between the best interest of the child and co-parenting. The family judges consider that it's best for the child to have the contact with both parents, even if the father is violent, which is a real big problem. And the international convention sets out the Istanbul Convention in its articles 31 and 45, require judicial authorities not to issue contact orders without considering incidents of violence against the non-abusive carer and the child, and to impose effective, proportionate, and dissuasive sanction. And those contact orders without considering violence are a violation of the rights of the children too, but it still happens. And we have to answer to that question, why are victims' rights considered secondary? And with Gwenola, we consider that one of the reasons that the victims' rights are considered secondary is because of the importance that the father's right discourses had for decades in France. And they structured kind of the way that the family law works in France. So we made a table. And this table is paralleling the tactics of the abusers, what the father's movement is demanding and won most of the time, and the consequent benefits for abusive men. So we must reveal the balance of power between the father's rights and the victim's rights. For us, they're in contradiction. So when the abuser wants to control the daily activities of the victim and intimidate her, the father's movement is demanding cooperating and joint custody without safeguards under the law of 4th of March 2002, and then the abusive man can have frequent contact with his ex-partner and children and can supervise the day-to-day decisions relating to the children. When the abusers want to isolate the victim, deprive her of resource and intimidate her, the father's movement is demanding to impose joint custody at the request of one parent and considering relocation as an obstacle to co-parenting. And then the abusive man can prohibit relocation under a penalty of transfer of residence and control the space of the victims. And when the abusers want to isolate, deprive of resource, intimidate, or make the victim responsible of the violence, while the father's movement is demanding to increase the number of convictions for failure to represent a child and request the transfer of residence on the basis of this conviction and file complaints against those who support women, then the abusive man can use coercion when victims resist control and use reprisals too, like the transfer of residence or the threat of transfer of residence. And then when the abusers want to make the victim responsible, devaluate her and confuse her, they can disseminate the idea that the accusations of violence are usually false, like the father's group do. The father's groups also want to get parental alienation recognized, and then the abusive man can silence the victim and discredit the victim. So the notion of parental alienation is a notion that is scientifically unfounded. It's a dangerous notion. And when the mothers use protective strategies against their ex-partner, coercive control, such as refusing contact, the woman can be accused of being alienating. The accusation of parental alienation in our research and in other researches may be explicit. They can also be implicit. And because of the accusations and the fact that the violence is not recognized because of the use of this notion, they are likely to lose the children's residence and live under the threat of losing it. And the experts and social workers may still use this notion, which tends to mask domestic violence and coercive control. I also must recall that the notion of parental alienation is rejected by the GREVIO, the monitoring body of the Istanbul Convention, and also by the United Nations. There is a report that came out a few months ago, wrote by Shazia Chaudhry, which is a professor of law at the University of Oxford, and she made a six-country empirical study of the experiences of survivors, judges, lawyers, and court-appointed experts in Bosnia and Herzegovina, in England and Wales, in France, in Italy, and Spain. And she saw that the use of family law proceedings is a tool to continue the abuse by perpetrators, and it's a secondary traumatization of victim of abuse, and it implicates state institutions in its perpetration, when access to children is mandated, when custody of the children is awarded to the perpetrators, and despite evidence of abuse. And she saw that the parental alienation is used in all of these countries, and the findings illustrate that there is a general level of mistrust towards disclosures of domestic abuse as a strategy to obtain legal aid, and an overemphasis of false allegation despite their evidence rarity. It's an echo of what we saw with Gwenola, with the discourse of the father's rights movements. And the human rights were viewed as background context rather than an active tool within proceedings, and they are rarely specifically cited by lawyers in their arguments, even though these rights were clearly relevant. So to conclude, in France, we have a little bit of hope, because the domestic violence is beginning to be seen as a possible exception to the principle of co-parenting and to contact orders. But the problem is that it's mostly in case of domestic abuse considered as severe by the judge, for example, repeated physical abuse or stalking. And the domestic violence is still not sufficiently considered as a violation of human rights that as such requires three protective measures. It means that we still have work to do. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Professor Prigent. I'm now honored to introduce Tamara Termites, a distinguished legal expert and advocate for racial justice. With over 25 years in the Federal Department of Justice, she has been instrumental in shaping truth and reconciliation policies. Please join me in welcoming Madame Termites.
Everybody. It seems that I have difficulty to share my PowerPoint, so I'm going to go through it and I could share it afterwards. So today I'm going to discuss about the racial profiling and the media situation. So first, I'm going to talk about the key historical fact with respect to anti-Black racism and discrimination in Canada. The overrepresentation of Black people, the racial contract, the definition of racial profiling, the major decision of the Supreme Court of Canada, proving racial profiling, and the racialization of the media conclusion. So racial profiling is a discriminatory practice that undermines fundamental civil rights while failing to promote law enforcement goals. We must acknowledge the past, a precondition to understand how racial profiling and discrimination is operating in our society. The situation in Canada, so there's a presumption because of the multi multiculturalism framework that there's no discrimination in Canada, but let's take a look at history. Black people in Canada have an history of oppression. Black people early history in Canada involved enslavement and segregation. In 1680, the King Louis XIV approved enslaving in Canada. The situation continued after the conqueror in 1760, enslavement was still in operation in Canada. In 1883, slavery was abolished in Canada. In 1910, Immigration Act prohibited immigrants who were declared unsuited to climate and requirement of Canada. In 1946, Viola Desmond was arrested and refused to move her seat in the white-only section in the movie theater, similar to Rosa Parks. 1962, the Immigration Act prohibition were abolished. In 1982, the Charter of Rights was enacted. It provides some legal protection against discrimination based on race, notably. In 1989, the Royal Commission on Donald Marshall Jr. Prosecution highlighted the nature of systemic racial discrimination toward Indigenous people and Black people in the criminal justice system. In 1988, the Supreme Court, in the decision of Williams, of the Supreme Court of Canada, in the decision of Williams, recognized the bias that are in the system. The court said that for some people, anti-Black biases rest on the unstated, unchallenged assumption learned over lifetime. The court said, in my opinion, an attitude which are ingrained in individual subconscious and reflect in both individual and institutional conduct within the community will prove more resistant to judicial cleansing than will opinion based on yesterday news and referable to a specific person or event. In 2006, the special rapporteur of the UN made his recommendation, and he was able to saw that, and his name was Dudu Dien. So Dudu Dien stated that racial discrimination is still in Canada is still tangible. The constitutional, legal, and legislative framework established by successive government provide a solid legal basis to the expression of a clear political will to fight with racial discrimination and to offer remedy to the victim. But there's a lack of intellectual strategy to confront and combat discrimination. Canada does not appear to have grasped the magnitude of its submerged part of the racist iceberg. There is now an urgent need for this strategy in the view of the resurgence of racism. So we were in 2006. In 2017, the report of the Working Group of Experts on People of African Descent in Mission in Canada presents some recommendation. In 2018, the Government of Canada endorsed the United Nations International Decade for People of African Descent. In 2021, the Court of Appeal of Ontario recognized the reality of anti-Black racism and systemic discrimination in the criminal justice system and its impact on Black people in Canada. Key facts, statistics about overrepresentation. Black people are overrepresented in the Canadian criminal justice system as victims, survivors, accused, and convicted people. The limited data does not allow us to fully understand the extent of and the underlying cause of this overrepresentation. Discrimination and hate crime. 46% of Black Canadians age 15 and over report experiencing discrimination in the last 5 years, according to a report of Statistics Canada from 2019. Police reported crime motivated by hatred of race or ethnicity increased by 20% in 2022. and whether the percentage of hate crimes specifically targeting 20 Black community increase of 28%. Incarcerated people in 2020 to 2021, 44% of the adults of Canada were Black, and they represent 9% of the population of the federal correction system. Black people have overall a rate of reoffending lower than the majority. 85% are not readmitted in the federal custody within the 5 years following the expiration of their sentences. And the Black people are more likely to be assessed as high risk, low motivation, and low reintegration potential, according to a report of the Office of the Correctional Investigator 2022. So this situation brings us to ask us, what is the impact of the racial contract on the Black population? So as you know, Charles Mill in 1987 defined the racial contract. So in saying that the social contract was in fact from its very inception inherently a racial contract. For males, the racial contract rests upon three claims. The first claim is white supremacy. The second claim is white supremacy should be taught as a political system. And the third point is that white supremacy is eliminating be terrorized based on the contract between white, a racial contract. For Mile, white domination is systemic, structural, and not simply the result of individual prejudice. So that brings us to the definition of racial profiling. The Supreme Court has defined racial profiling as any action taken by one or more people in authority with respect to a person or a group of persons for reason of safety, security, or public order. This is based on the actual and presumed member in a group defined by race, color, ethnicity, national origin, and religion, without factual ground or reasonable suspicion that result in the person of a group being exposed to differential treatment and scrutiny. Racial profiling include any action by a person in a situation of authority who apply a measure in disproportionate way to certain segment of the population on the basis of their race, as an example. The major decision of the Supreme Court on race, regarding race, you have Spence, the decision R versus Spence, 2005. The Supreme Court said that the court have acknowledged the racial prejudice against visible majority is so notorious and indisputable that its existence will be admitted without the need of evidence. In the decision of Grant, 2009, the Supreme Court said judicial notice on how race could affect detention under detention analysis, when you observe our experience tells the court that a growing body of evidence and opinion suggests that visible minority and marginalized individuals are at particular risk when unjustified low visibility policy intervention in their life. The latest decision with respect to racial profiling is the decision from Lee in 2019, when the Supreme Court recognized firmly the impact and the nature of racial profiling. Racial profiling occur as a day-to-day reality in the life of those minority affected by it. Racial profiling is anchored in an internal mental process that is held by a person in authority, in the case of the police. That internal process is created by systemic racism and has been acknowledged by the appeal court in other decisions. The court also underlined the fact that, moreover, the majority left the door open when the evidence on race relations may inform many issues of litigation, including credibility assessment, determine that evidence is accepted as persuasive. The evidence of police officers is often evaluate with the presumption that they have no reason to lie or to mislead the court, despite that they are the merely human, have a wide range and unique motivation for saying that what they do under oath, as well as a feeble memory like the rest of us. There's no special category of witness that police fall into. Racial profiling is a reality in policing in Canada that is supported by significant social research. And the court said that the judge it's open to the judge to find that true racial profiling may often happen. It often to a judge to find that true racial profiling may often happen. It did not actually happen on the particular fact of the case. There's two recent decisions in Quebec with respect to racial profiling impact. One is that the city of Montreal has been sued under a class action, and the first level of tribunal find that the class action can go ahead and some damages should be given to the Black people who were arrested under the framework of racial profiling. And the second decision is a decision of the Court of Appeal in the case of Procureur General, Attorney General of Canada, of Quebec versus Lumba, where the court under the charter have arrived to the conclusion that the illegal interception are contrary to the charter, Article 9, which is illegal detention, and 15, the equality framework. So how to prove racial profiling? The racial profiling rests on the shoulder of the person who alleged. So thus, is the accused has to submit some proof. Example of proof that the court accept is expert evidence, public report, qualitative research, public consultation, declaration by the police and the mayor in the case of the class action. And also internal documents such as strategic plans and evaluation of strategic plans. So the process of racialization must be deconstructed to expose the multitude of meaning attached to the construction of racial profiling. And that's where the media is part of the construction of the social discourse. The discourse is not just a symptom of the problem of racism. Essentially, it reinforces and reproduces the racialized belief and action of the dominant culture. Media actively participate to the construction of the discourse of otherness. This discourse has political, economic, and cultural societal impact. The media are able to establish boundary of the public discourse from which priority are set by the public agenda. The media also can make moral and racial panic, which are like the concept that developed by Cohen and Hall with respect to moral panic, and the concept for racial panic focusing on the alleged racial deviance associated with Black bodies. And at the end, there's the recommendation in Canada. We just received like 2 months ago a report from a roadmap for transformative change Canada Black Justice Strategy. The recommendation with respect to racial profiling is to introduce legislation codifying the prohibition of racial profiling. And there's a recommendation about national standard in policing in Canada, because as you know, in Canada, we are like a federation with provinces. So the guidelines should apply to all provinces. And another recommendation is increase the police accountability for brutality, excessive use of force, and harassment. Conclusion, racial profiling exists, yet it does not keep citizens safer from violence, because it's an act of violence itself, and an act that challenged the ideal and core value of a democratic liberal society. Racial profiling by police is the canary in the coal mine. It alerts us to the reality that insidious and systemic racism exists in all our supposedly democratic institutions. Data Henry, The Color of Democracy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tamara Termitas, for your presentation. I would now like to invite Professor Hogeman to introduce our next speaker.
Okay, thank you so much, Luisa. Thank you so much, Professor Tamara Termitas, for your speech. Incredible. Thank you so much. Our next speaker is a really, really good friend of us, Professor Anna Tarnowski from Poland. She's professor at the Faculty of Law and Administration of the Nicolau Copernicus University in Tarum, Poland. And her speech is entitled Shaping the Standard Law, the ECHR and National Case Law Influenced Polish Assembly Law. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I try to share my presentation. Could you please confirm that you can see the presentation? Is it all right?
Yes, we can.
Oh, great. That's good. Thank you very much. It's an honor to be in such a great company that deals with such amazing topics in human rights. I'm really inspired during these 2 days of meeting. Thank you to organizers for including my proposal in the program and for all your efforts put in organizing this meeting. Thank you, Osvaldo, Edna. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, Luisa. Today, I have proposed a topic linked to scientific project that we are developing with some colleagues from Poland. And based on that, we are also intending to create an international research group, as we already know how much national systems of protection for freedom of assembly can differ in the legal basis, the system of guarantees, the legal mechanics of assembly itself. So we are trying to make an in-depth analysis of this very classic civil liberty, freedom of assembly, and we are analyzing its conditions in relations to the changing momentum of history in order to really understand how to secure this freedom optimally and how to anchor it in a democratic regime. So we try to understand how this dynamics works. There is, of course, much legal history in this. I hope I will not bore you too much. I will focus on the most recent history, that of the freedom of assembly in Poland during the period of transition and seemingly consolidated democracy. It is from the early 90s till the one nowadays. From 1990s, there was a new regulation, new law, which constructed the freedom very liberally. It's basically European constitution, continental tradition that we have separate laws for this basic type of assembly, and sometimes side by side with other specific regulations for specific mass gatherings, for specific assemblies like electoral ones, sometimes religious ones, even those of the universities. The key point is that since the 1990, it is only necessary to submit a notification to notify the mayor, to the mayor or city president, in the case of largest cities, of the intention to organize a gathering. And as a rule, this step is sufficient to legalize it, at the same time to obtain legal protection. Certain prerequisites can be the basis for prohibiting, for the ban on assembly. It is the risk of loss of life, health, damage to the property of significant size, and the promotion of lawful purposes, probably very well known from your own domestic laws. In 2015, a new drafting of the law of assemblies was enacted, which is more detailed and extensive. We really like to over-regulate, I would say, in Poland. It also protects still spontaneous assembles without a former organizers, which take place in direct opposition in the immediate aftermath of specific events, for example, a specific piece of legislation, work of parliaments, a specific court judgment, or even sometimes words of the politician. And it would be pointless to organize it otherwise in the other moment, in the other place. The question I would like to answer today concerns the factors that have influenced the specific shape of our law on assembly regulation. I will focus on the role of European Court of Human Rights jurisprudence and national courts, particularly the Constitutional Court. I'm examining how practice led to correcting or improving the national regulation on assemblies. The European Court of Human Rights sets, of course, a standard for the possibility of public expression and dissent in various forms, including challenging government policies and decisions. And this element cannot be treated narrowly. That was the case Ciloglu and others versus Turkey. Likewise, under Article 11 of the European Convention on Human Rights, an assembly is protected even if the demonstration is disruptive, annoying, or offensive to those with different views. There are also several other elements developed by the European Court of Human Rights building this high standard, but I will concentrate on this very first, because in this context, the European Court of Human Rights took a position in a case from Poland that was called Bączkowski versus Poland, and this case concerned the banning of the 2005 Equality Parade in Warsaw. The then mayor of Warsaw, who became later president of Poland, Lech Kaczyński, refused to allow the LGBTQ parade to march through the city, justifying his decision on the grounds that the organizers had not presented a road plan for organizing the movement, that such a parade would promote a homosexual lifestyle in Warsaw, and that he personally objected to the promotion of homosexual orientation. Just 20 years ago, really, and it was shortly before the election, so he really dared to formulate it like that. However, despite of the formal ban, the march took place on 11 June 2005. Some 2,500 people attended it. It was rather small event at that time. Now it's really huge events several times a year, even with 50,000 of attenders. So it's really great. And I think that was a case why it became greater and attended by more interested persons. The day before the parade, organizers still appealed to the second administrative instance, which ruled that the city could not require an organizing plan and the parade was unlawfully banned. But that was, of course, formally too late. However, the organizers appealed to the European Court of Human Rights, pointing that the other matches of the day had taken place legally, and their status, of course, was unstable, undetermined. That was without this formal protection of police. The European Court ruled that although the march eventually took place, the fact that the city authorities banned it constituted a violation of freedom of assembly under Article 11 of the European Convention of Human Rights. The court also ruled that Poland had violated Article 14 of the convention because other marches held on the same day were not subject to the same conditions as the march for LGBTQ rights. In addition, court also ruled that there had been a violation of Article 13 of the convention on the right to an effective remedy, effective repeal, as the organizer had no legal procedure available to them to appeal decision before the day the march was due to take place. In 2015, law, the Polish legislator built a different appeal system against the ban of assemblies. The organizer can appeal immediately to the ordinary court, which operates in a standby mode. And I would like to emphasize that this mode was proved really very successful since 2016. And in practice, Polish courts really passed the test as the power protecting the freedom of assembly. However, of course, still happen some situations of banning assemblies. For example, those promoting certain political goals different than by worldview of some mayors, but courts thoroughly examine the grounds for the ban applied. In fact, against this background of practice, I would put the thesis that municipal authorities are shifting the responsibility for organizing assemblies that address topics with which the mayors did not agree to the courts. Just, okay, dear voters, it's not my problem. I tried to stop it, but it's the courts are to blame that such an event took place. The courts are also connecting bans based on the promise of risk of harms. The mayors must make this risk plausible. There still are paradoxical cases in which presidents have banned assemblies based on the risk of damage caused by counter demonstration. And of course, the courts cleared the situation. So this is the type of influence undoubtedly related to the European court standard applies in particular to the practice of organizing assemblies in Poland. And in case of the Polish Constitutional Court, the Constitutional Tribunal, we have had a direct impact on the letter of law. This is also as the form of amendments to the older law of 1990s or this new regulation. Completed 2015. As an example, I can mention the declaration as unconstitutional of the article of the original regulation that an assembly must have a minimum of 15. That was rather a strange condition, and it was probably associated with the experience from the communist regime, which readily recognized conversations in the street by a few people as illegal assemblies. However, the tribunal ruled that this requirement was unconstitutional, and even small gathering is protected, could be protected. In another of its judgment, the tribunal also referred to the legal capacity of the organizers, and now it's translated to precise indication in the new law. The right to organize assemblies does not apply to persons without the full legal capacity. It means the minors cannot be organizers of the assembly. The tribunal also helped to consolidate this European court reasoning, if only on the issues of the simplified organization. So I mentioned notification instead of the model of obtaining consent, which we had for decades before. Second European court jurisprudence had created a positive model of high quality, and despite of isolated slip-ups, Polish courts have perpetuated this deepened process and understanding of freedom of assembly. Paradoxically, the legislator did not always consider the European court take, for example, when it attempted to significantly separate the counter-demonstration from the actual assembly. A new type of assembly, the cyclical assemblies, privileged over others, also raises great doubts expressed, for example, by the Polish Ombudsman and other institutions. This amendment was introduced to the law in December 2016. The Constitutional Tribunal found them constitutional, but did so with a panel appointed under a previous Law and Justice Party government, according to the procedure, very doubtful, very controversial, contrary to the law, I would say. The controversy surrounding those judges' appointments goes forward to the present days, as, for example, judgments appear and that the current government does not publish them due to the defective composition of the court, of this tribunal, constitutional tribunal. The violations associated with this appointing process, with appointing judges, have caused a profound collapse of confidence in the tribunal, which was really a decade-long, very established, very, very esteemed legal institution in Poland. And I would say it's just to summarize, I would say it's important to acknowledge the tribunal's earlier positive and fundamental influence on assembly legislation while remaining aloof, distant from the latest judgment. Thank you very much for your time. So, Athens, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Tarnowska. Our next speaker is one of the main responsible for the happening of this great event. Professor Edna Raquel Hogeman is an esteemed legal scholar and educator with a profound commitment to advancing human rights and social transformation. As a permanent professor at the Federal University of the State of Rio de Janeiro, she serves as the Dean for the Center for Legal, Political, and Administrative Sciences. With expertise in bioethics and human rights, supported by her doctoral and postdoctoral achievements, Professor Hogeman's work bridges disciplines and nations, fostering innovative perspectives on both governments, sustainability and global justice. Her dedication inspires both students and colleagues alike. Welcome, Professor Hogeman.
Thank you, my dear Louisa.
Thank Professor Anna for your speech. Incredible. In fact, it is a great privilege to present the closing lecture for this international meeting on human rights, constitutionalism, and public policies to transnational perspective, promoted by the PPGD of the Federal University of the State of Rio de Janeiro, where over the past 2 days, we had the honor of welcoming distinguished professors and researchers from some of the world's most renowned universities to our institution. We extend our heartfelt gratitude and appreciation to all participants, reaffirming our commitment to coming together again for the third edition of this event in 2025. But let's talk about bridging borders, transnational public policies, and the G20 commitment to ending hunger for a shared future. Well, the global challenge of hunger and food insecurity continues to affect millions, despite significant strides in the field of international development. However, through the collaboration of transnational public policies, governments, international organizations, and other stakeholders, there is growing potential to address this persistent issue, particularly in the context of the G20's commitment to ending hunger. So I will explore the role of transnational public policies, focusing on the initiatives and commitment by the G20 to achieve a hunger-free world, examining their strategies, challenges, and potential solutions for a shared future. Okay, transnational public policies refer to the efforts and agreements that span national borders, involving many governments and international actors to address common issues. These particularly important as food insecurity is not only a national issue, and we can say it just because in our country we had a lot of problems with food insecurity. But this problem also exceeds borders. The lack of access to nutrition food in one country often has carrying effects, influencing trade, migration, and regional stability. But we must emphasize that the Global Alliance Against Hunger and Poverty, introduced during the G20 Leaders Summit on last November 18th in Rio de Janeiro, represents an important step toward eradicating hunger and poverty by 2030. This alliance underscores the necessity of transnational collaboration, particularly supporting low and lower middle income countries to tackle food insecurity and economic disparities. This coalition, which already includes 148 members comprising 82 countries, international organizations, financial institutions, and NGOs aims to implement robust public policies and allocate essential resources to comfort these global challenges effectively. Brazil has led by example with initiatives like Bolsa Família, which has significantly reduced poverty and inequalities. Complementing these efforts, the National School Feeding Program ensures millions of students receive nutritious meals, particularly in marginalized regions of our country. Such programs not only improve food security, but also enhance educational outcomes and future economic opportunities. During the alliance's launch, Brazil President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva emphasized the paradox of a world producing ample food while 700 million people remain hungry, as highlighted by the FAO. This alliance, for sure, reframes hunger as a justice issue, urging commitments that transcend rhetoric. So it requires signing the declaration of commitment, symbolizing a pledge to enact policies and mobilize the necessary resources. Beyond addressing hunger, this alliance contributes to broader sustainable development goals, such as reducing inequalities, SDG 10, and promoting responsible consumption and production, SDG 12. Once again, I would like to express my gratitude, my deep gratitude to all our guests, professors, and students from our university and other educational institutions present here during these 2 days. I'm pleased to inform you that all presentations will be available on our YouTube channel, and the abstracts will be published as part of the event proceedings. We look forward to your participation in the next edition of our event in 2025. Wishing everyone a Merry Christmas and a new year filled with success and accomplishments. I here declare our event closed. Thank you so much.
Matt?
Thank you so much. Goodbye. Have a nice day. Oh.
Goodbye. Thank you.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Nice goodbye to you all.
Goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Goodbye. Thank you.